So welcome everybody. So Boradara Froizo, Diocham Amino Ginani. Thank you for joining us for this knowledge sharing webinar. I'm Harriet Green. I am co-chair of the Centre for Digital Public Services. Welcome to our 11th knowledge sharing webinar. Part of our brief is at CDPS is to enable knowledge sharing and for people to share best practice. We've run knowledge sharing webinars on topics like user-centered design, data, bilingual service design. And today's webinar is focused around the initial one-year anniversary of the publication of the amazing Braille Digital Strategy. And we're going to hear from three organisations today about how they're using the digital strategy to shape their digital delivery. We're going to hear from Natural Resources Wales, Sports Wales and Neath for Talbot Council. We're joined by leaders from each of those organisations to take us through some of the work that they're doing. But before we get on to that, it's really exciting to have joining us today Deputy Minister Lee Waters, Deputy Minister for Climate Change, a relentless and inspiring supporter for digital change. So thank you very much for joining us, Minister. And so the format today is that we'll hear from our three featured public bodies, and then we'll hear some reflections from Lee and also some reflections from Myra Hunt, my co-chair at CVPS. And then we'll have some time for questions. So do please be thinking of your questions, but we're going to save those for a Q&A session at the end. We don't have simultaneous Welsh translation today, but we do have Flinos on hand to translate questions that we receive in Welsh. So please feel free to post your question in Welsh and we'll have that translated. So without further ado, I'll go on to welcome our first speaker, and that is Claire Pillman, CEO for Natural Resources Wales. Welcome, Claire, and I think you have some slides to show us, so over to you.
Diolch, Harriet. Boradar Pawb. Thanks, Harriet, and good morning, everyone. Really good to be here this morning. You asked, first of all, to sort of start with my digital experience and just sort of frame that a little bit. And I suppose I should say that I worked for 7 years for what is now the Department for Digital, Culture, Media and Sport as Director for Culture, Tourism and Sport, and saw during the time the digital work really grow. Reflecting on that, I had two inputs into that. One, I was the person who came up with the idea of swapping out department and digital, and thereby remaining DCMS and becoming Digital, Culture, Media and Sport. And the other thing I did was I chaired many interview panels for board members for the 45 arm's length bodies that DCMS sponsored, who were looking for digital leadership at board level. And I suppose two things to take from that. You don't have to be a tech wizard to contribute to digital strategy and development. And the second thing is that digital leadership at board level and exec level is often as much about business transformation, organizational development, and customer focus than about the technology. And those sort of framing experiences are what I brought to my role in NRW when I joined in 2018. So NRW was created in 2013, a little bit of history there, bringing together the Countryside Commission for Wales. Can we have the next slide, please? Forestry Commission for Wales and Environment Agency for Wales. So those three organisations, all the services they delivered, were brought together. Many of those services depended on web content, data, systems and tech functionality that were provided previously by the parent bodies. So in the early days, there was a focus on replacing systems, websites and applications, and to transferring and maintaining legacy data assets and establishing NRW's standalone capability and capacity. We also had to make sure that the organisation maintained business critical services. And there was immense pressure at that, in those early days, to replace like for like quickly, bringing in minimum viable products, MVPs, based on our view of requirements, more often or not based on a sort of hunch of what was needed, rather than on user needs and research. And, you know, a minimum viable product is not a bad thing. It can be a good approach to getting something developed quickly and in front of users. And we use the term for products that went live, but I think really straightforwardly, you know, a lot of those products were not really good in terms of what our customers needed. They were very much the minimum viable product for us. They weren't necessarily what our customers needed. So over the last sort of five or so years, that work has continued, and we've ended up very straightforwardly in many cases with disjointed services, different platforms, systems that aren't integrated, and too much content that is effectively impenetrable for anyone but the most determined service user. And that's, you know, something that many organisations would understand and share. What we now need to do is break that cycle and reposition our starting point for designing services, putting user need at the heart of what we do and the beginning of every discovery and developmental journey. If we help the people to do the task that they need to do or find something out themselves, we make it better for them and we free up our expert staff for doing the things that they uniquely can do. So it helps us and it makes regulation and advice really so much more user-friendly. And I would say there's a real sense of change in the air at NRW and more broadly in the public sector in Wales, and a recognition that this is about much more than technology. So, sorry, can you just skip to the next slide now? So the digital strategy for Wales came at at a very opportune time for us. We had lots of people in NRW who had been banging the user-centered design drum for many years. Roles such as content designers, we'd had a user researcher internally who'd worked hard on the ground to drive change. But the standards introduced in the strategy and critically the introduction of CDPS have given those people in NRW the confidence and support to pursue their objectives. So we began by reviewing our own strategies for digital data and technology last summer. We started off with a warts and all SWOT analysis of where we were, and that brought out a whole load of really good data and evidence that we could work with. And all the while we were doing that with one eye on the developing Wales strategy and the particular bits that were most relevant to us. We took a challenges and opportunities paper to the board, our board, in September, and we've been engaging internally and externally on the draft vision and five missions in the strategy throughout the winter. And we now have a draft strategy going to the board for approval next week. This commits us to putting our customers and users at the heart and start of service design, to adopting the 12 service design standards and to embarking on the significant culture change required to deliver on this ambition. Next slide, please. And just to be really straightforward, we know this won't be easy. That is perhaps a slightly exaggerated, I think, you know, a smaller mountain and perhaps not quite so much ice might be appropriate, but hey ho. And that the hard work really starts now. It will mean new ways of working for everyone, And some of the challenges we know we will face because we've already started to articulate them, but others we haven't even really sort of got there yet. But the ones that we're looking at the moment and really focusing on are around governance. So how do we get our governance procedures right to support a more agile approach? And how do we plan better around new user needs? Second one, how do we build genuinely multifunctional teams around service products and owners? So we've got some good starts there. You know, we've done a lot of work in integrating our workforce. So some good building blocks there, but a lot further to go. How do we develop the skills that we need? And that's something I'm sure will come up time and again in this morning's session. How can we finance and resource the transformation needed? Really critical one there. How do we make our evidence accessible in the simplest ways for the most users, while also allowing the experts to dive into the detail? And finally, something that I think, you know, we all recognise, how do we get a balance between keeping the business going, keeping those services being delivered, and enabling some people to step off the hamster wheel to think about how we transform the business? But we haven't, you know, we're not just waiting for the board agreement to the strategy. We've started making the change because I think with any big cultural change like this, you need to be able to take people with you, inspire them, energize them, get those people who are naturally interested and enthusiastic, involved and engaged. So we've started to make some small and incremental improvements. And we've also been working with CDPS on a demonstrator project on waste registration, where they're helping us to tackle a problem in a really good user-centered and agile way, building on our staff's experience and insight and giving us that help in challenging ourselves around the customer interface with what we do and how we can improve that. We've just finished the discovery phase and looking at what the alpha stage looks like. We've used user research to help shape improvements as well during this period. So, you know, we're feeling that we've got some good exemplars around our flood warning services, including sort of postcode searches for flood risk. So we've got some good areas where we can show the change. And we are also improving the woodland creation content on our website as a result of the timber deep dive led by the minister. So we've got some areas where we can say, look, it's really making a difference. I think that will be critical in taking the rest of the organisation on this journey. I'd also just shout out that we've been doing some training. CDPS have been just great and have opened up opportunities for us at all levels over the last 18 months. So our board, exec, leadership and some specialist staff have had some really good sessions to introduce us to some of the concepts. And we'll be doing more of that in the year to come. So just to wrap up, you know, this is a journey. It's always very useful when you have sites with lovely long curved boardwalks that you can show in these circumstances. We're at the very beginning of it. We're completely straightforward about that. There's a huge amount that we can do. And I think we can all see the potential and the possibilities. And what we need to do now is to get that digital strategy cleared by the board and then really start that process of prioritization, getting more products agreed and looked at, and critically building this into just the way we do things in NRW. So it's not a digital add-on, it is absolutely fundamental. It's at the beginning of every process. It's not a sort of in a box to one side. So that's just a really quick snapshot of I suppose, our journey to date, and it would be really interesting to hear others' reflection and other journeys to see whether, you know, there are differences and similarities. But thank you very much. Diolch yn fawr iawn.
Thank you so much, Claire. Diolch, that was such a thorough all-round picture you gave us of the ambition and the challenges and how you're addressing that. It's fantastic. So I'm sure we'll have some really interesting questions. But again, please save those for the end. So we're going on to our second speaker now, who is from Sport Wales. It's Liam Hull, who's head of corporate performance. So Liam, I think these are your slides that we're seeing now. So please continue.
Diolch, Harriet. Bore da, pawb. Good morning, everyone. So my name's Liam Hull. I'm the head of corporate performance at Sport Wales. And I thought it would be good to look at the sort of the progress that we've made and the impact that the digital strategy for Wales has had on us as an organisation over the last 12 months or so. Next slide, please. So in terms of the biggest impact at Sport Wales and moving from sort of the top left-hand corner across, I think the first two areas go hand in hand. So you can have the best digital principles in the world, but if your staff don't understand them or they're not set up to work towards them, then they're ultimately meaningless. So we've put a lot of effort into upskilling our workforce. Just one item that I wanted to pick from that box there is the service design in practice course that we put four members of staff through. We purposely picked four members of staff from different parts of the business. One, to encourage collaboration and sort of cross-departmental working, but also for them to become advocates and take the learning and knowledge from that course back out to in their teams. And we saw some real success through that. We set up a digital group as well, which is again cross-departmental with different skill sets from across the organization. And part of that group's work initially was to get out and speak to all areas of the business really and understand the challenges that they are facing and how digital can support them. And through the insight that we gained through that work led us to developing a digital roadmap, part of which was to develop more integrated and accessible services. So there are some practical things we did, like making our website more accessible and ensuring that our services continue to be developed bilingually. But the end goal for that roadmap was ultimately to have a one-stop portal where users could access any service the Sport Wales provides. So as we develop that roadmap, ultimately that's always in the back of our mind to work towards that goal. We've invested quite heavily in our infrastructure as well to make it more resilient as a result of working from home and having a more dispersed workforce. We've moved to a cloud-first approach as much as possible. So we have got some legacy systems that are hosted on site, and they are being prioritized over the next 12 months to upgrade to new services. And we've also made significant upgrades to our cyber defenses as well. As a sporting organization, we get targeted more than most. So we've really had to up our game around cyber, both in terms of the controls and the processes that we've got in place. We've also invested in additional cyber defense software as well. And that last box there is around providing and accessing support. So firstly, we provided more support to the wider sporting sector, but recognizing that we are not always best placed to provide that support. So some of it has been bringing partners together to discuss the challenges they face, and we've facilitated that. But a lot of that support has been signposting to digital resources that are available or experts that they may not be aware of. And then I think there's been a recognition at Sport Wales as well that we don't always have the internal capability and capacity to deliver some of the work that we want to do on our own. And that led then to the partnership that we had with CDPS. And I thought it would be really useful to take you through, use that as a bit of a case study and show the link back to the digital service standards, because there's real synergy there through that piece of work and the digital service standards. Next slide, please, Gemma. So the case study itself, the project that we worked on was trying to increase the reach and impact of our community funding. So what are we talking about when we say community funding there? So the majority of funding that Sport Wales gets in from Welsh Government and National Lottery is redistributed out into the sector. And community funding in this instance, we're talking about your local football team, your local netball team, or your local running club that needs support and use an application-based approach to apply for funding. I'm not going to go through everything on that slide there, but there's just a couple of things that I wanted to pick out, and it's around the why and the how of the project itself, because that's where I think the most synergy is. So firstly, why did we want to carry out this work? And it's ultimately bottom left there, make sure everyone can use the service. That is the driver behind this piece of work. It couldn't be a clearer link to the digital service standard. We want to make the service as accessible and as easy to use as possible. And that's not the system itself, so the grant system, but that's the entire end-to-end user journey from finding out about funding through feeling supported through the application process, right through to how they evaluate the impact of our funding as well. And moving on to the how then, again, how we can increase the reach and the impact of our funding, we need to understand the barriers that people are facing. And to tackle that, we carried out some really robust user research with different groups of people. So there's people and organizations who've successfully used our current system. There's people who have unsuccessfully tried to access funding and have failed. But most importantly, there are groups of people who have never applied for funding from Sport Wales or have never even heard of Sport Wales. And that was where we really gained some valuable insight through this process on the barriers they're facing and how we can tackle them. Next slide, please, Gemma. Again, there's the remaining digital service standards here, which I'm not going to talk through them all in a huge amount of detail, but just to pick out a couple. The first one around having a multidisciplinary team. The approach that we took to the core project team was to bring people from CDPS and Sport Wales together, which they would obviously bring a range of skills, knowledge and experience, but they would also bring a really different perspective. That was something that was invaluable as we moved throughout the project. And then where I think CDPS really pushed us out of our comfort zone in a positive way was to get us to work out in the open. So through things like regular show and tells internally and externally, blogs as the project was progressing, presentations to different stakeholder groups as well. That really changed the way that we report progress through projects. And I think that's something that we've taken forward across the rest of the organization. And then I just wanted to reflect on the change ultimately that this has brought around for us. I think in years gone by, the approach that we would have taken is to procure a new grant system, commission some external research around the barriers that people face, and then try to mesh those together at the end to form a service. I think there would have been some positive benefits from that approach, but it wouldn't have been anywhere as beneficial as this joined up end-to-end approach. And I think through our new strategy, we recognize that there are some ways that we need to change our approach. But through the digital service standards and working with CDPS, that's given us some real practical examples of how we can do that. And something that previous approach definitely wouldn't have left is a legacy at the end of the project. And I think that's something that's been hugely beneficial to this piece of work. Next slide, please, Gemma. And again, just to talk through some of those legacy benefits, I suppose. Firstly, the personal development of the staff that are involved in the project, not just in terms of their skills and knowledge and experiences, but their personal confidence, which is each and every one of them has grown exponentially, I would say. And I think working in the open has been a huge part of that. So getting them in front of people presenting to different groups has had a hugely positive impact. The next bullet there, upskill staff, is slightly different. And it's something that Claire touched upon as well in her presentation. The working in partnership with CDPS has given us access to a whole host of training courses that they've run. And there was a huge uptake from staff outside of the project team who've accessed those courses and have been upskilled as a result. Through the user research as well, we've also spoken to a whole host of people and organizations who we've simply never spoken to before. And those connections have been made now, and they'll hopefully stand the test of time and hold us in good stead to continue making improvements going forward. I've already touched on the change in approach to sharing progress. So I suppose the last bullet point and the most important for me on this slide, I think, is prior to this work, I think we did recognize that we didn't have the skill sets internally to do this on our own, but we weren't quite sure what we needed. And not just through the project itself, but through the support of CDPS, speaking to myself and the other sponsors as the project has progressed. I think we're in a much better position now to understand what we need going forward. So, as I said, there's been some huge lasting legacies from this project that will be massively beneficial to Sport Wales in the future. Next slide then, Gemma. I think that's it. Nothing left for me other to say. Thanks for listening. Diolch yn fawr iawn.
Thanks so much, Liam. That was brilliant to hear. Again, it's the kind of all-round picture that you're giving. And of course, it's fantastic to hear that it's valuable to be working with CDPS. So thank you very much. So we're going to move to our third speaker, Chris Owen, who is Chief Digital Officer for Neath Port Talbot Council, also an advisory panel member for CDPS. And I think this is your first slide, Chris, that we're seeing. So carry on.
Thanks, Harriet, and pranam da pau. Good afternoon, everyone. Nice to see you all. There's so much synergy with what Claire and Liam have just run through. It's really reassuring from my perspective to hear that there's multiple organisations facing these challenges and to just hear it, from the coalface is really good. I know it's cheesy, but, it's really an exciting time at the moment to be involved in public sector digital transformation in Wales. We say digital transformation, but actually it's much broader than that. And that's the message we're trying to get across within the council now. It's about real business transformation and taking that digital element out of it and looking at it more holistically. As the others have said, there's now a fantastic range of support available to call on through the brilliant teams at CDPS and WLGA. And layered on top of that, obviously we've got this digital strategy for Wales, which is really helping us on this really challenging journey that we're on at the moment. And I say challenging, and that really is the right word for it. Changing baked-in approaches to service design and delivery is really, really tough going. In Neath Port Talbot, we're really trying to make a commitment to changing these approaches now going forward. And over the next few slides, I hope to give you a bit of an insight into where we're going. For those who are not aware, Neath Port Talbot is located in South Wales. We're a county borough. We have around 144,000 residents across the county borough, and they receive a real wide range of different services from the council's around about 7,000 staff. So, it's a big organisation and lots of challenges. Move on to the next slide, please, Jen. So I took up role as Chief Digital Officer in July of last year. I was previously with the Welsh Government working on a digital edtech programme for school delivery across Wales. But when I came into Neath Port Talbot, one of my first priorities was around really getting a current baseline in place of how the digital services division was currently operating. What that found was, like many other local authorities across Wales and across the UK, we were essentially operating as a traditional IT department, reacting to service demands that were coming in. So it was a very reactive service. We had a lot of legacy technology in play, burner platforms running, lots of old ways of working. And clearly there's a lot to do to change that. So we set about developing a new target operating model, which is going to get us on this path for transformation. And what I'm really clear about is that it's not just about more technology. It's not about more platforms. It's not about more solutions to problems we think exist, but it's about really looking at user-centered design, placing our citizens, businesses, and visitors at the heart of service delivery. It is about a whole council shift. It can't be done in isolation by digital services. We can't be just the end of the chain where something's been decided, we're gonna buy a solution, throw it over to IT and they can just plug it in and it'll all work. you know, we have to look at the end-to-end processes. We have to look at changing those traditional approaches, if you like, which is going to require strong leadership across all of the directorates from the senior teams right the way down to the guys on the ground. So, you know, there's a hell of a lot of work to do in that space. But clearly there's, you know, good alignment there to mission one within the digital strategy for Wales around delivering and modernising services designed around user needs, which is simple, secure and convenient. Just to draw attention to that bottom line that I've got on that slide there, it really is about that evolution, that change, and adopting those approaches to make sure that we properly use digital data and technology to transform how the council operates. Can we move on to the next slide, please, Jem? So the target operating model I've developed is based around six key strands. I'm not going to talk through the technical ones there today, which are the environment and application delivery approach, but clearly they are really important because we need the technology, or we need the products and the solutions to deliver the services. But what I want to focus on today is more around the other four elements there. So we'll start with governance. Again, if you can move on one for me, Jem. So good governance is clearly key to building strong foundations. I think the others have mentioned putting governance in place, get those governance approaches really pinned down. So what we're looking to do in Neath the Talbot is to develop a corporate digital solutions board, which I'm hoping is going to help to start breaking down some of the silos that we have in play across the organization at the moment. The amount of, you know, disparate case management systems that we have, reporting systems that we have, all because departments are just looking at their problem, going for a solution, implementing that solution, has to change. You know, we need to bring these things together, and we need to move away from that, you know, constant reacting to those who are shouting loudest to us as well, and make sure we get proper prioritization around the work that we're doing. So scrutiny of requests, aligning back to the digital service standards that we've developed, which I'll come on to in a second, aligning to security and compliance, financial planning, end-to-end understanding of service problems, but also properly road mapping solutions that we're putting in play. It's not just about spinning something up, deploying it, and then forgetting about it. It has got a lifespan associated with that. We need to recognize that, and we need to make sure that we're properly planning around it. So hopefully putting some of these steps in place will really set us up for success when we're commissioning new products and services. Move on to the next slide, please, Jem. So the digital service standards that I've mentioned. So again, nothing new here, really. It's all based on the GovUK, the Welsh Government, and the CDPS service standards. So we're not reinventing the wheel. But what we're hoping to do is to really develop the MPT digital service standards across our service delivery ecosystem, helping the council to think differently about how we approach the development of products and services, how we put people at the centre again, you know, keeping coming back to that user-centred design, to ensure we create and run great public services across the county borough, because that's what it's all about at the end of the day. We want to outline what's really expected from new and redesigned digital services, and help our delivery teams ensure that they're aligning back to best practices from the outset. So we're constantly coming back to the standards, testing what we're doing, understanding that we are delivering it in the right way. So again, under these standards, we've got sort of three key areas around meeting user needs, providing good service, and using the right technology. So it's around building that sort of structure. Moving on to the next slide is all around workforce. I think Claire mentioned a bit around workforce in her area. So, you know, I'm very fortunate, and you know, there's no getting away from this. I've got a great team here in Neath the Talbot. They are receptive to change. They want to embrace new ways of working. They want to sort of break the shackles of the traditional IT section that they've been viewed as in the past. So, you know, getting the staff on board, you're halfway there, really. So what we now need to do is to develop the workforce to make sure it's skilled, not only in just the technology aspects, but around how we develop, you know, the broader digital data and technology solutions to meet those user needs. Understanding what problems we need to be solving, mapping out requirements, rather than just simply jump into those tech solutions, as I mentioned earlier. So there's a real shift required in that space. So looking at the skills that we've got, doing a gap analysis, working with CDPS and WLGA on the training opportunities that they're putting into play, all of that will help us build this new model. looking at things like distributed leadership, developing sales and client functions across the business, all of those good things we're hoping are going to make us much more integrated into the service areas, as I said, rather than being seen as this bolt-on. Just jumping into the next slide around communications, clearly key, you know, internally, externally, let people know what we're doing, getting them a clear understanding of our priorities, direction of travel, but again, breaking down those silos is really important. Data, as a county borough, we have a vast array of data, all in disparate databases, services, not linked up, not properly, looking at the end-to-end experience for our users. We've got to crack that, we've got to change that approach going forward. We need to make sure we've got a much better joined up view of our service users and use all of that data and those insights to inform service design. So move away from the anecdotal to the actual fact and then build services around what the data is telling us. On to the next slide. What I just wanted to demonstrate here is that you can't develop a digital strategy in isolation of the wider corporate plans, the wider corporate objectives. So what I'm pains to do is make sure that as part of our new corporate plan going forward, we're linking in where appropriate to make sure that there is that flow through and that join up. So as part of the new corporate plan that we're developing at the moment and about to go live, we have a number of strategic organizational development enablers around people, digital governance, etc. And what I've tried to do is take the people enabler and look at it through a digital lens and look at what actually we're trying to make sure that all people within the organization understand. So again, it helps us get that sort of cross-organization buy-in and understanding of where digital fits in into the picture. On the next slide, I talk about effectively the strategic change program that we've got underway. There are a number of design principles. Again, it's that join up and that link through. So where we talk about one council, leadership and teamwork, trust and empowerment, etc., all of those strands are threaded through the new target operating model. So it has got that join up and it is, as I say, it's not being seen as a bolt-on or something separate. It's got to be part and parcel of our delivery. And then on the final slide, basically what I've started to map out is some of our success measures and benefits. And, you know, this is an industry in its own right. KPIs, the KPIs say, what are we measuring? Why are we measuring it? And in a lot of cases at the moment, to be perfectly blunt, what we're doing is measuring failure demand. So why are we measuring failure demand? And, clearly we need to know about failure demand. But if we're looking at how long it takes to answer a phone call come into our contact center, what we should be asking is why is that call coming into the contact center in the first place and how do we stop it from coming in by providing the right service, hopefully up front, to improve that overall service that the citizen is getting from us. But thinking differently about these measures and benefits, looking at the quantitative and qualitative aspects of it, there's, you know, just a start for 10 here in terms of some of the ones that we're developing at the moment. And underneath these will come many sort of further metrics to help us sort of identify these. But it is all really around that customer lens, that user-centered design, making sure that we're focusing on that. So yeah, really quick whip through of the journey that we're on at the moment. We are in early days, but hopefully you get a bit of a sense of the direction of travel here.
Brilliant. Thank you, Chris. Absolutely. Again, another really all-encompassing tour of the work you're doing. And it was really interesting to hear that and lots of interesting focuses there on user need, but also, you know, KPIs and the education that's needed at a senior level to enable and get the leadership you need and the support you need. So thank you very much, Chris, and to our three speakers. Now we're going to move. I'm going to ask Minister Lee Waters and then Myra Hunt to give us a few minutes of reflections on what they've heard before we move to our Q&A session. So Lee, what were your reflections on hearing those three very, very thorough depictions of journeys that our bodies are on?
Yeah, I don't want to say very much, to be honest. I'm sick of hearing myself. But I'm just really encouraged by that. I think, you know, going through them, I think it's vital we have senior leaders who get the stuff. And hearing what Claire had to say at the start was really brilliant, because hearing a chief executive of a major public body saying all those things starts to make it normal and mainstream. And that's the thing, isn't it? It's the whole forming, storming, norming, performing stuff. is just it, what's brilliant about these meetings and what the work, the network the CDPS is building up is we're creating a community of practice effectively, mm-hmm. Where people can support each other and show that this is not novel or particularly out there. This is pretty humdrum, really, but it's not very humdrum in the public services. It doesn't need to be like that. It can change. It doesn't need particular experts. Neith Patalbert are very lucky to have somebody like Chris. And it's clear the difference he's made there. But I think it's about saying this is what we expect. This isn't about exceptionalism. Well, they're great. They can do it because they've got Chris or because they've got this. Is how do we make this what we do? And that's the challenge for us. And that's why the work of the CDPS is so important. And they're so glad to see organisations like Sport Wales coming forward and being keen to do this. And going out of their way to make it their business. So that was great. And so the reflections Liam had about their experiences, and now it's beginning to seep into the bloodstream of the organisation. They can see the advantages to them rather than just we've ticked the digital box. Actually, in terms of our business as usual, and people who may not get this can see how it makes their organisation and their jobs better. So that's brilliant, isn't it? So it's just getting these messages out into the mainstream, which, you know, a year ago we weren't doing, 2 years ago we weren't even thinking about, 3 years ago we were shouting into paper bags. So there's a journey here, and everybody on this call is part of it, and I'm really encouraged. And I think the key thing now is to keep saying user-centered, keep emphasizing, as Claire did, you know, minimum product, you know, just getting something done. Let's not be perfect, be the enemy of the good. We've got to try stuff. And I think just embracing that iterative approach and learning from failure and listening to users, I think that is exactly what we need to do. And then the questions in the chat, and I think the challenges everybody identified are great challenges. And it's great to see them now working through that. And that's what the centre is there for, isn't it? To help figure out those challenges and then spread the message. I think that would be my final point, really. Is, you know, you all have a responsibility to spread this amongst your peer groups as well. So this is a great support group, but let's get it into everybody else's business and take some of the fear away.
Brilliant. Thank you so much, Minister. Right, Myra, a couple of minutes for you to add your reflections before we move to the questions.
Yeah, I just want to say that. It's absolutely wonderful hearing the presentations. It's incredibly nice for myself and Harriet, because it's sort of looking at the other end of the telescope for us. It's actually hearing from the people that we're working with rather than us, you know, bearing down on our teams and discussing it from our point of view. So it's really lovely. And it's also so nice to sort of hear the common threads running through, which for us are really about skills and training from the highest boardrooms, as Lee is saying, you know, to encompass all those different levels. And actually one of the pieces of feedback that we've had is how important it is to train managers who are managing digital staff, because often people can feel really confused and disempowered and want support bringing in new staff and particularly new digital skills. And I think perhaps the only thing that we've missed out in the three presentations is recruitment, that Harriet and I need to look at how we recruit together across Wales and really make a lot of noise in the recruitment space so that we can start attracting skills and make sure that we retain people before we allow them to be exported and go elsewhere. So I think we need to add recruitment, because that's perhaps missing today. It's lovely to see, and I'm so grateful, and Harriet and I are so grateful to these partner organisations who've welcomed in our digital squads and worked with the teams, and that everyone who's come to work at CDPS has said how nice it is and how super the departments are and the organisations are that we're working with. So that's very reassuring. Just one other point that I'd like to make that perhaps hasn't come out here is I was talking with the Society of Local Government Chief Executives yesterday and saying that, you know, digital transformation is not a spectator sport. You learn by doing, and we're all learning together. And one of the things that we were discussing is how service design as part of that starts to cut across organisational boundaries. So I think that is going to be something on the journey, following Claire's lovely journey slide on one of those bends, is that actually as we follow through that service design, we will start hitting organisational parameters and boundaries, and we're going to need together to work out how we work across organisations to deliver better services in Wales. Thank you.
Brilliant. Thanks, Myra. Thanks. So we've got some really good questions on the Q&A board. So and we've got about 10 minutes for them. So can I ask the panellists to be relatively brief so that we get through them, because they're very good questions. The first question is from James Lewis to Liam. Liam, did the community funding project identify user problems caused by the grant funding process itself? And if so, was there any scope to consider changing these ways of working? Liam.
Thanks, Harriet. So the short answer is yes, it did. Some of the research that we had back was just an application in itself is really daunting. One interview that I conducted, somebody said, I haven't applied for funding from Sport Wales because I haven't got a degree and I feel like I need one to apply for funding. So certainly that's given us some really good feedback, and some groups that we spoke to as well felt like, well, just give us the money. We are closer to these communities to be able to distribute it on your behalf. So we've had some really good insight in that area as well. It's something that's under consideration at the moment.
Yeah, brilliant. Thank you. Thanks, Lynn. So I'm going to move on because we've got some good questions too. Catherine Hornung's question for Chris Owen. Really critical question. How do you go about prioritising the pipeline? This is definitely a challenge that NRW is grappling with. It's a question we're all grappling it with. There's so much to do. How do you prioritise, Chris?
Yeah, it's really difficult. I think we're looking at it through multiple lenses at the moment, because we've got the burner platforms, the legacy technology, etc., which is driving some of the timelines, because there's some immovable deadlines around technology that's not going to be supported anymore. So we have to put in place an alternative for those to make sure that we can continue to deliver the service. But then when it comes to the future work and the future pipeline, I think what we're trying to do is to get real open, transparent conversations at our digital solutions board around what is the real priority here, guys. So in environment directorate, you've got 20 things on the backlog at the moment. Of those 20 things, what really are the must-haves? What's got to be done quickly? In education, have the same conversation. Social services are the same conversation, etc. But then get them to come together. So collectively, corporately, we're looking at, is the environment one of the biggest ticket items? Is the education one of the biggest ticket items, etc.? So that we can then lock in the resource, we can then put it onto the pipeline, and everyone is cited and everyone's had a chance to comment on it, rather than just doing it in isolation, which is how it's been done in the past, really. So it's difficult, and not everyone's happy with it, but you've just got to go through that process.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Chris. And a question for everyone to comment on. Maybe I could ask Claire to jump in on this one. So the question is from Ben Wilkins. As the transition to agile working embeds, how are you continuously improving the processes of developing products and services in a more cost-effective way beyond the standards? Claire, is that something that you could comment on?
Yes, I mean, I think that this is, you know, one of those things where you are just learning as you go along, and it is often, you know, those things that actually are most difficult and sometimes haven't gone very well, where you learn the most. I was also really struck, though, and I think there's a relationship here, by one of the comments on the chat about the way in which we can engage better with those sort of sections of society who are often least able to engage with services. And I mean, a sort of core thing for us is environmental justice, and making sure that actually, as we move to tackle the climate and nature emergencies, we ensure that there is a just transition and the role that digital can play in that. And I think that point that actually it is often through working with others, and the third sector, it was a question about involving the third sector. So I think there's something for me that's really interesting about the potential partnerships and the way in which that actually this can't just be us doing things, us learning from these, us sort of in our little silos doing things brilliantly. There is something extraordinary that could happen if we do things in a joined up way together. And I think that that's what I've taken from this, was, you had three presentations which told different bits of the same story. And there's something for me about how we as public sector leaders in Wales actually start to join up using the good offices of CDPS to help us, but so that that learning and those connections are made. So really, really good. Thank you.
Thank you, Claire. Thank you. There's a question from Neil Pryor, again to Chris. Chris, agree that you need management on board, but how about your councillors?
Yeah, Chris. Absolutely valid point. Our members play a vital role in the process here. We have a member for digital. I link in very closely with them, but there needs to be clear understanding of how the way digital data and technology can support transformation within the council, and the members need to be across that as well, so that they get that understanding. So there is more work to be done in that space, but it's a really valid point and they absolutely have to be on board with it.
Can I just jump in there and turn the question back on Neil, because Neil is an exceptional councillor, but he's unusual because he comes from a digital background, but he's working with councillors who do not. So I'd be really interested to know what Neil thinks. Is he spot on? That's a problem. What's the solution? What does he suggest?
Hello. Can you hear me? Hi. Okay. Hi, thanks for, yeah, no pressure.
Yes. It's
one of those back office functions, isn't it? I mean, I find a lot of councillors, and Minister, you probably find this as well yourself, you know, you've got the things that are visible to people will be the things that we see on the news. So in a local government context, housing, social care, education, these are the things that I think traditionally councillors will be very clued up on. So it's a constant battle. You know, it's a constant, you mentioned earlier about seeping into the bloodstream of the organisation. That is what we have to do continuously. And in Pembrokeshire, the leader was very forward thinking and actually had a cabinet member for transformation. And the first thing we did was, I called it technology, put that at the heart of what our transformation programme was about. So, and it's been 5 years. Convinced that every elected member gets it, but if Chris, if you've got a couple of good ones, then yeah, keep working with them, you know, make sure that it's at the top table, and because it'll come sooner or later. I think one of the things that did show me that things were changing was one of my older councillor colleagues FaceTimed me. You might have done it by accident, but that showed me that, you know, the pandemic forced that behaviour change, so we've got to capitalise on that.
So I'm not sure Neil or Chris came up with any answers there, which shows it's difficult, but it's a real problem. So can I suggest that we try and take this away and work on it, and maybe Neil and some others, we can get together and have a think about, I'm happy not to be involved, but have a think about what we can do in this space, because it is hard, but B, it is vital.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Agreed. Yes, I'm sure we can help with that. I'm sure CDPS can help with that. So I'm just going to pick one last question now, given we've only got a minute left, and it's about the digital strategy, and it's about what external factors might impact on the success of the new strategy, and how might that be approached. And I guess that's a question from Manon Wigley, and I guess that might be about new emerging issues. Well, can I ask the panel what they think about on that question? Who wants to pick that one up?
I can kick off, Harriet, if you'd like.
Go on.
I think what COVID has shown is that under pressure, we can make decisions quickly in government and respond quickly. And clearly now we have the Ukraine situation and Wales wanting to be a super sponsor and putting forward those proposals. So I think there is going to, it's pace and change and responsiveness and the need within government now to be able to mobilise much more quickly and respond much more quickly, and the expectations of our users, customers, people for us to do that. And that will be one of the biggest challenges for us, and digital will be part of that, but we will need to address that.
Thank you. A great answer, Mara. I'm going to actually wrap us up there because we're coming to the end of our hour. So again, to everybody, Dioch.
All right, we've got Lee's got his hand up though.
Oh, Lee, come in, please.
Sorry, just to add to the question, I think cyber is a massive issue and a real threat and could well make people wake up to why digital is important, even if it is from a risk-averse, accounting officer. Christ, I've realised this is a problem. Part of it. Maybe for some people, the way into this journey is from a negative experience. But I think we should all be very worried about cyber, and all organisations need to be asking themselves, are they doing the basics?
Yeah. Great. Thank you. So thank you to everybody. I think this has been a really meaty, but also really kind of inspiring session. We've covered an awful lot of ground. And we've had some good questions. So thank you very much. I'm going to close it there. Our next knowledge sharing webinar is the 26th of April, and that will be on digital accessibility. So finally, thank you. Dioch amamino gidani. And hope you found this useful. Goodbye, Vio. Hodin wedi. Hoko helpiki. Thank you very much indeed for joining, and see you at the next one.